It's my pleasure to welcome all of you here this morning as we come together to celebrate the life of Violet Brennan, who our daughter Sharon has recently described as an English rose. We are all here to say our formal farewells to Vi, to pay our respects to her, and we must try and bring some comfort to you, her family and friends, who've gathered here today with heavy hearts, I'm sure, saddened to have lost Vi from your lives. We remember too, as we sit here, that there will be others who have known and loved Vi who aren't able to join us here today, but who will nevertheless share in your sense of loss at this sad time. And I know that Vi's sister Betty and sister-in-law Kath will both definitely be with us in their thoughts today. Together we must commit Vi's body to its natural end, with perhaps some comfort in knowing that she has lived a good and very full life, and that she is now at peace. Vi's family have requested to have a simple and straightforward funeral ceremony here today, in keeping with her outlooks and beliefs. And so together we will pay tribute to Vi and recall the unique and very special lady that she was. Sharon has worked so very hard to ensure that this ceremony will be a fitting and appropriate celebration of her mum's life, and I am honoured to have been invited to officiate here on behalf of the British Humanist Association. Of course, I'm quite sure that none of you here will need me to remind you that this is a sad day. We are quite naturally saddened whenever we have to attend the funeral of somebody we've known, and it's absolutely right and quite natural that you should all grieve for Vi, because your sadness is a reflection and a measure of the love, the happiness and friendship that you've all shared with her. The pleasure of having Vi as your friend and a mum may indeed now be lost, but the joy of having had that relationship and the delight and comfort of your memories will never be lost. To match the sadness of losing Vi, you have the real pleasure of having known her, and I hope you'll all find some comfort in the many happy memories of her that I'm sure you'll have to cherish. All of you are here today because Vi was special to you, and I'd like to invite you to join me now in a round of applause for Vi, for a very special lady and her life which has been so well lived. Ceremony gets underway, I'd like to invite Vi's neighbour and good friend Sandra to come forward to read the first poem Sharon has chosen for today.
As you all know, Vi had a love of the royal family, so it's fitting that this poem was read out at the Queen Mother's funeral as well. It's entitled She Is Gone. You can shed tears that she has gone, or you can smile because she has lived. You can close your eyes and pray that she'll come back, or you can open your eyes and see all that she's left. Your heart can be empty because you can't see her, or you can be full of love you shared. You can turn your back on tomorrow and live yesterday, or you can be happy for tomorrow because of yesterday. You can remember her and only that she's gone, or you can cherish her memory and let it live on. You can cry and close your mind, be empty and turn your back, or you can do what she would want, smile, open your eyes, love and go on.
Thank you. Although I never had the pleasure of knowing Vi myself, I did speak recently to Sharon, and she told me quite a bit about her mum's life and her personality. And it's my pleasure now to begin the tributes to Vi by reflecting briefly upon her life with you all. So I learned that Vi was born Violet Bachelor in Lambeth in London, and she was the eldest of three children born to her parents Sid and Helen Bachelor. She spent her early years growing up with her sister Betty and brother Gordon, and during the Second World War, they were all evacuated out of London to live in Frodsham. At the end of the war, Violet returned to London, but sadly, her parents separated then, and so she and her sister had to go and live in a children's home, and that's where they were raised, in Harpenden. Violet's young life certainly had its challenges, but by the time she was 18, she'd moved to live in Highgate and found work first in Woolworths and then in the Gordon's gin factory. It was during this part of her life that Violet met Charlie, when they were both lodging in the same boarding house. A good relationship soon formed between them, and they married in November of 1957, when Vi was still just 23 years old. Charlie was Irish and came from Sligo, and Violet's father very much disapproved of their marriage. It caused a rift between him and Vi that was to last for many years. By contrast, Charlie's big family were extremely welcoming to Vi, and over the years, they had many happy holidays visiting members of Charlie's family back in Ireland. We're now going to watch the first of two visual tributes that Sharon has prepared for today, with some music that she's also chosen especially for this occasion.
Only you can make all this world seem right. Only you can make the darkness bright. Only you and you.
Lovely old photographs there. I'd now like to invite Sharon's friend Jet to come forward, and she's going to read in a second poem that Sharon's chosen for today.
If roses grow in heaven, don't think of her as gone away. Her journey's just begun. Life holds so many facets, the earth is only one. Just think of her as resting from the sorrows and the tears in a place of warmth and comfort where there are no days and years. Think how she must be wishing that we could know today how nothing but sadness can really pass away. And think of her as living in the hearts of those she touched, for nothing loved is ever lost, and she was so much.
Well done, Chet. Thank you. Thank you. As was clear in the pictures we saw a few moments ago, Vi and Charlie were a very happy and very much in love couple. Charlie worked on the railways, and at the end of the 1950s, he was offered the opportunity to move here to the new town of Stevenage. They moved together to Shephall, where they enjoyed the camaraderie that existed among the neighbours there, all of whom were newly moved into this area. As Vi and Charlie raised their family, there was a great community spirit and many parties. Charlie played for the local football team, and Vi was always extremely proud of him. Vi was a very good wife and mum who took excellent care of her home and family. She believed in working hard too, and for many years she worked outside her home as a dinner lady at the Barnwell School. Outside of work, she and Charlie shared a good social life and often frequented the Shamrock Club in Welwyn Garden City and the Times Club here in Stevenage, where they enjoyed the music, the bingo, and most importantly, the company of many good friends. Charlie was an easygoing and affable man, and they were a very popular and well-regarded couple. In time, Charlie encouraged Vi to re-establish contact with her dad, and they were both very glad to have each other back in their lives. Vi and Charlie were hard-working, decent people who took good care of their family and were excellent and very supportive role models. They enjoyed a good life together, but things changed in an instant when in 1988, Charlie was involved in a very serious accident at work that almost cost him his life and resulted in him losing a leg. Together, he and Vi had to rebuild their lives as Charlie gradually recovered from this terrible shock. As he learned to walk again, Vi was beside him, supporting him every step of the way, and it was a very proud moment for them both when his recovery seemed complete. They were fortunate during those tough times to be surrounded by so many good friends and to have their love and support, which was so hugely valuable to them as Charlie learned to live again. Charlie then retired from work with a big retirement party, which was well attended by his colleagues and management from the railways, and he was always so very well known and highly regarded by all who knew him. Sadly though, before too long, Charlie then developed cancer and died in 1994, 2 days before Violet's 60th birthday. This was naturally another very sad and difficult time for Vi, as she had to learn to adjust to another new life, this time on her own. It was then that she started going to the bingo on a daily basis, and her lovely friends that she made there really helped her to give meaning to her life and have a reason to carry on. When the Mecca Bingo was threatened with closure, Vi was one of the regular members who was interviewed by the local paper, and she had a lovely picture taken which she proudly kept. Sharon and Tim decided to make their home here in Stevenage so that they could support Vi and make sure that she had everything she needed. With the help of a gardener, Vi was able to stay in her own home, and she very much looked forward to visits from her mobile hairdresser, who gave her a real boost. She had some wonderful friends and neighbours, but despite this and regular visits from the family, there were times when Vi was lonely. She grew very fond of Tim, who was a terrific son-in-law, and she even followed the scores for his football club, Burnley, so that she knew how his team were doing each week. When Sharon and Tim got married in 2004, Violet enjoyed an extraordinary day at their wedding. She was so proud to be there and enjoyed being made a fuss of by Tim and Sharon's many friends. She was pleased to get to know Tim's son Callum and grandson Corey and was proud of their achievements and took a real interest in what was going on in their lives. She was always very generous to them and other family members when it came to Christmas. One of Vi's most constant companions was her budgie Joey. She had many budgies over the years and they were all called Joey. She looked forward to regular phone calls too from her sister-in-law Kath, and the two of them loved to chatter away on a Friday evening. They'd talk away like schoolgirls and had always been lifelong friends. As time went on though, Vi's health began to fade, not helped by the fact that she so enjoyed her cigarettes. Although she wasn't in the best of health, I understand in the end that her death came rather suddenly and unexpectedly, just after she'd had one of those regular Friday night phone calls to Kath, when she ended the call by telling Kath that she was feeling a bit better. Although I know you'll all be greatly saddened to have lost Vi, Sharon told me she's drawing some comfort from knowing that her mum died very peacefully and without any fuss in her own home. It's clear from all I've heard about Vi that she's had a very good and full life. She and Charlie were an excellent team who worked hard to raise their family without ever losing the romance between them. But they faced some real challenges too when Charlie had his accident. Vi then had to adjust again to life on her own. It wasn't easy for her, but she remained a decent, honest woman who did her best and rose up to all the challenges that life presented her with. We're now going to pause again and have a second set of photographs that Sharon has prepared for today, showing us some of things that happened in her mum's later life.
When I am down and oh, my soul so weary, when troubles come and my heart burden be, when I am still and wait here in the silence until you come and sit with me. You raise me up so I can stand on mountains. You raise me up to walk on stormy seas. I am strong when I am on your shoulders. raise me up to more than I can be.
I'd now like to invite Sharon to come forward, as she was keen to pay her own tribute to her mum this morning.
Hello everyone, thank you so much for coming. I just wanted to say a few words really about what mum was like, and just to give you an idea of the tribute that we're doing today. Mum loved Fray Bentos pies after her and her sister Betty rediscovered them in the pound shop. She loved Paul O'Grady's The Love of Dogs programme, and she would always ask me every year for a West Highland Terrier calendar. She loved Princess Diana and the two boys, as she called them. Still never believed that it was an accident in Paris, and always said Diana had been murdered. She loved bingo, and I love the fact that she loved bingo too. The fact that she had her own independence and she was in a safe electric pink and blue hall full of friends who could share stories and pass away a few hours. That was fantastic. She loved Vanderbilt perfume. I would always get that for her at Christmas, and I'd have to source it on the internet because it was quite hard to get. And she would always leave a sweet scent as she slowly walked by on her walking frame. My mum was a big fan of her CDs. She would stand in the kitchen putting her makeup on to the strains of Boyzone or Take That, or the latest X Factor winner. She loved watching Simon Cowell on television for his sense of humour. She then would go upstairs before bingo to get changed from her daytime outfit of cardigan and trousers to her evening outfit of skirt and cardigan. She was very proud and tidy and would attract compliments for the various colours of cardigan ensembles. She loved having her hair done by Karen, her hairdresser. They would chat and have fun whilst the perm was taking. She always felt so much better after she'd had her hair finished. She loved looking into her garden, and Paul, thank you, a gardener, became good friends, and he often made sure that she was okay, as did her family and friends from Bingo, who would call up and arrange lifts. Her regular Friday calls from Kath, her sister-in-law, were at 7 p.m, and they would settle down for a weekly gossip, as only lifelong friends do. Mum's favourite time of year was always Christmas, without a doubt, sending you all her Christmas cards at the very first opportunity. She had a wonderful tradition for us of all opening 10 presents at 4 o'clock, after having eaten a turkey dinner, followed by a cooked ham salad tea for the evening meal, cracking Brazil nuts, watching Top of the Pops, followed by the Queen, and shouting "No deal" to Noel Edmonds, while sipping a glass of Baileys with lots of ice. EastEnders music starting, and then the Christmas cliffhanger ending. Mum couldn't wait to find out who killed Lucy Beale. I've told her, so it's fine. Her love of Christmas became an institution, and we were so lucky to have spent the last 20 years of them together. In the beginning, after Dad died, we would visit the cemetery at Western Road together, all three of us, and Mum would often ponder the day that she will be resting there with Dad. We had another great day this Christmas, and the pictures over here, I've chosen just to symbolise that. That was just a month before she passed, so it's an incredible achievement that she had such a lovely time. We love celebrating birthdays just as much, always trying to get the same magic that we had on Christmas Day into the birthday. Her very last birthday was the big one. It was her 80th, and we had a wonderful day together, even though it was the day that Shirley Temple had died and the weather was really stormy and windy. So I'd like to show you just a small home video that we made of that great day, and we can take time to enjoy the marvellous moments together. Thank you, Mum. You did a great job, and thank you so much from my heart.
It's the 12th of February, 2014. Mum, I'm going to do an interview with you regarding your special birthday, which is week 8 of. Right, you're on camera. Have you got any messages to say on camera?
Thank you for all the presents.
Misty watercolor
memories.
A message to Canada.
Thank you for all the presents.
Of the way we were.
That was lovely, Sharon. Thank you so much. It is, of course, the uniqueness of each person's life that's the reason for our grief in bereavement. We could search throughout this whole world, but there is not now, or nor will there ever be anyone who's quite like Violet. But she still lives on through the family and in all of your memories. And although she is no longer a visible part of your lives, Violet will always remain a member of this family or of your circle of friends through the influence that she has had on you and the very special part that she's played in your lives. So hold on to Vi in your thoughts. There is no need to part from her quickly. Talk about her often, repeat her words and sayings and jokes you will have shared, and enjoy your memories of Vi and all the happy times that you've spent with her. Although this is clearly a sad occasion for all of you here, we must never forget the love and happiness that Vi herself spread, and we must be optimistic about the future because better days will surely come again to you all. Here together in this last act, in great sadness, but without fear, in love and appreciation, we must leave the part of Vi that we cannot keep to its natural end. Violet, I'm sure I speak on behalf of all of us who are with you here this morning when I say to you now, we all rejoice that you lived, and we are so glad that we knew your face. We took delight in your friendship, and will always treasure that we walked part of our lives with you. We will cherish the memories of your words, your achievements, your character, and your many fine qualities. With love, we leave you in peace, and with the greatest of respect, all of us here bid you farewell. Vi is now safe. She's beyond fear, beyond harm, and beyond any more pain. In great sadness for her death, But with thanks for her life and all that we've shared, we must remember her. And finally, let us remind ourselves that the dead do not reside within the grave or in an urn, but safe as a treasure within the hearts and minds of all those they have known and loved. So hold on to your memories of how you have all shared with Vi in the many joys of living. As we leave here now, we're going to conclude our ceremony with a final piece of music. And whilst it's playing, you are all welcome to come forward. And I believe some of you have got flowers to leave with Vi as we go on the way out. And we're listening to a final piece of music that Sharon's chosen, appropriately called The English Rose. Thank you.
The first train home.